Here this morning, we are, as I was talking with Brad, we are flowing in grace. So we're kind of figuring it out along the way, too, which is what life is about, right? So I want to welcome all of you and welcome folks who are joining us other places and other times. This is a very holy time that it's all holy, but when we come together and are intentional about it, it kind of helps us to realize the connections throughout, and they keep moving us into the new life that's opening up. I want to begin, if y'all could put the welcoming candle is part of the tradition of lighting, and know that that light is within you. You know, Peter Mayer's song is very good about that little light of mine shining within. So know that that light is with us, each and every one, and as we gather, we feel that catalyst for new life, love, and change. So join with me as we say the welcoming candle prayer. Come, come, whoever you are, wanderer, worshiper, lover of leaving, it doesn't matter. Ours is not a caravan of despair. Come, even if you have broken your vows 1,000 times, come yet again.
Thank you, Zen Lin. Everybody, I would like to invite you to stand and sing this rocking song with us. It's another Ruthie Foster song, just like we did one of her tunes last week. Elena's going to lead this sucker off, and I think you'll know what to do when it hits you. Y'all ready?
Oh, I woke up this morning with my mind.
Sing here.
It was stayed on freedom.
All right.
I woke up this morning with my mind. And it was stayed on freedom. I woke up this morning with my mind. And it was stayed on freedom. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. Well, let me tell you that I'm walking and talking with my mind.
Sing it now.
It was stayed on freedom. I'm walking and talking with my mind.
Come on.
It was stayed on freedom.
Come on. was super fun. Have y'all ever seen Kirk Franklin before? You know, I've kind of felt like him for a second. Like, there's someone really singing, and he's just like the hype guy. He just like, come on, yeah. Like, that's all he does. That's all. So I was your hype man for that one. It was pretty. It was an honor. Hey, if y'all would just take a moment and offer one another a sign of peace. Mill about the room. Say hello to some people you don't know. You can grab a seat now if you'd like. I don't remember if Lynn mentioned that Todd Kirk is preaching today. I don't know if he left. So you're in for a treat. C, period, Todd Kirk is going to preach today. He's going to bring the word. It's going to be a lot of fun. Prepare to have your mind bended. But first, what we like to do now in this service, we've been doing for years, is we enter into the Kairos time, where it's a little bit more introspective and thoughtful. And so we start off with a song and then some guided meditation. So get ready. I want to invite y'all to sing on this. Like this.
If I were to pray, if I were to pray, in the breaking of the morning or the dying of the day, what would I say? What would I say? What would my heart speak? If I were to pray,
verse 2.
If I were to sing, if I were to sing, my soul could give some honest offering. What would I bring? What would I bring? Are the simple truth? My soul would want to sing, yeah. And if I do, will not the earth bend me? Will not the sacred life in all creation turn to lend a knee? Will not my song throughout cosmos ring and swim that crystal river that flows through every vein? Thank you.
first verse again.
If I were to pray, if I were to pray, in the breaking of the morning or the dying of the day, what would I say? What would I say? What would my heart speak? If I were to pray,
Richard Rohr is a Franciscan who says, prayer is not so much about changing God's mind as changing our mind. And I think some of the lines in this, it's sort of listening with the heart and soul. And there are all kinds of ways we can do that, and we can do it throughout the day. But in those times of transition, we're especially a little more likely to be paying attention to what that soulful calling is. I want to say real quickly, I'm going to read this poem, and there are copies in the back if anybody on the way out would like it. We have a group. I was telling Brooks Harrington, if anybody knows the Justice Ministry guy, I was telling him about the group called Practicing Prayerful Presence, and he laughed and said, come on, can't you get another P word in there? And I thought for a couple of seconds, I said, well, how about prophetically? Because as we practice that kind of prayerful listening and are present to others in that way, something prophetic happens, that there are awakenings and changings and transformations that often we're just way too busy to pay attention to. And so I want to encourage you all to think about in your own life what helps you to pay attention to the heart. The word obedience really comes from a Latin word meaning to listen, to hear. And we often make it this kind of militaristic, yes, sir, and it's not what it is. It's about hearing in that deeper way that we know we are part of that creation, that ongoing creation. I wrote a blog this last week about the group called Practicing Prayerful Presence. I didn't have prophetically in there, but I might change it up a little bit. But there's a book that we're going to be looking at by Parker Palmer for 7 weeks, Monday, Wednesday, Friday, 9:30 to 10:30. It's always open. Doesn't matter if you can't come to many of them, if you come late, if you leave early. It's about welcoming each of us where we are. And that's what we try to be in those groups. Somebody in the group shared this poem as we were having a conversation. He said, somebody gave me a poem. I'd like to read if it's okay. So he read it. We said, yeah, thank you. So we read it in another group. I read it in Disciple Church this morning, and I'm bringing it here now because it says so much to me about that kind of prayerful presence. It's called Safety Net. This morning, I woke thinking of all the people I love and all the people they love and how big the net of lovers. It felt so clear, all those invisible ties, interwoven like silken threads, strong enough to make a mesh that for thousands of years has been woven and rewoven to catch us all. Sometimes we go on as if we forget about it, believing only in the fall. But the net is just as real. Every day, with every small kindness, with every generous act, we strengthen it. Notice even now, how as the whole world seems to be falling, it is there, for us as we walk the day's tightrope. How every tie matters. Amen.
All right, we're about to get the full Kirk experience, y'all. Todd picked this song. His daughter Claire Kirk is going to sing it, and his son Ian is going to mix it. So here we go.
Before you open up the dirty window, let the sun illuminate the words that you cannot find. Reaching for something in the distance, so close you can almost taste it. Release your inhibitions, feel the rain on your skin. No one else can feel it for you, only you can let it in. No one else can speak the words on your lips. Rid yourself in words unspoken, live your life. Begins, the rest is still unwritten. I break traditions, sometimes my tries are outside the lines. We've been conditioned. Before you open up the dirty window, let the sun illuminate the words that you cannot find. Reaching for something in the distance, so close you can almost taste it. Release your inhibition, feel the rain on your skin. No one else can feel it for you, only you can let it in. No one else, no one else can speak the words on your lips. Rid yourself with words unspoken, live your life with those words.
Hi. Well, good morning, everybody. Good morning. Good morning, people out in cyberspace. Hello, everyone. Welcome. Good morning. I realized when I was preparing this, this is my 13th time to be a guest speaker. I know. And since I think the first one I did was 2015, so it's been, you know, that's over many years. But anyway, and I'm happy to be here. I'm very thankful for the opportunity, so thank you very much. 1111 is kind of a mystical number, supposedly, but so is 13. I'm not sure 13 is a lucky number, so if sometime during my sermon the ground starts to swallow me up or something, don't be surprised. Anyway, well, the title of the sermon is Everything Breathes, and breathe with me, please. Yeah, just take a deep breath. Send me your positive vibes, especially since it's sermon number 13. So anyway, so that song, Live Your Life with Arms Wide Open, that's a great feeling and a great message, a very refreshing message, I would say. I would call this a transcendental song in a lot of ways. I'm going to come back to that point. But hopefully some of you have gotten to live your day with arms wide open today. Maybe you had a particularly good day. The trick is trying to get it to work all the time, right, on a consistent basis. And that's really the game. Anyway, so it's kind of a transcendental song, a transcendental message, because the song is not so much about what's happening in the world as it is about what's happening in our own minds and how we adapt to it and maybe our subjective interpretation of it. I've got some more transcendental lyrics for you. See if you know this one. Now chiefly is my natal hour, and only now my prime of life. Anybody know who that is? No. That's Thoreau. That's Thoreau. Good guess, though. You got the transcendentalist, yeah. So, yeah, that was one of our own American writers and legends, Thoreau there, talking about the importance of the moment, that everything really happens in the moment and the rest is an illusion. But so you can see there's an American tradition. There's a very strong American tradition of inner light and looking for the inner light. It's sort of our version, our country's version, our culture's version of the, I guess you might call it the perennial philosophy. Now, some of you may have heard that term before, perennial philosophy, and you may associate it if you've, there was a book by Aldous Huxley that came out right after World War II. I doubt any of you are old enough to have read it when it came out, but perhaps you've read it in reprint. Maybe that's where you've heard perennial philosophy, where he kind of summarizes the perennial philosophy. But that term actually first appears about the time of Martin Luther. Martin Luther, obviously the famous Protestant reformer, and of course enemy of the Catholic Church because of his reforms. So the very first person to use the term perennial philosophy, and the one that's responsible for it sticking kind of and being used up to this day, is this guy. This is August Stucco, and he was a Catholic priest. And he was staunchly opposed to Martin Luther's reforms. So what he did was, is he did this really in-depth study of cultures, classical cultures, Rome, Greece. He looked into tribal traditions. And what he wanted to do is build a case that you can find elements of Catholicism all through the world and in the past. And in doing so, he felt like he was proving the validity of the Catholic faith instead of the Protestant faith. That's where the term comes from. He called it the perennial philosophy because he felt like it supported the Catholic Church. Anyway, it's changed. Now it's kind of this idea that if you look into all religions, or at least the mystical traditions in all religions, you find that the same kinds of ideas come up in every religion. It doesn't matter whether it's Christianity or Islam or Hinduism or Buddhism or in the tribal religions. You get a lot of the same themes. And I'm not going to go over all of those. That would be a great college class. But just to summarize in the shortest possible sentence to summarize kind of what the perennial philosophy is everything is one. And you hear Tom hit on this a lot. He talks about dualism and monism and all that kind of thing. But it's related to that. Everything is actually one thing. There is one thing in the universe that gets divided up that looks like separate things. But actually, at its very core, it's one. And that has some interesting implications. So that means that there is one truth. It comes out in different ways. It's understood in different ways. But there's actually one basic truth in the universe. There's one energy that actually is enlivening everything from the rock, from the rocks up to us, to our thoughts, everything. There's one consciousness that comes through in all organisms and in all people. There's actually one place and one time. It looks like there's lots of times and lots of places, but there really aren't. This particular statement goes back thousands of years, this idea of perennial philosophy, especially among the Hindus. But it doesn't surprise us this much as moderns because of Einstein, right? We're living in the post-Einstein world. We know that time is weird, and it's not what it looks like it is. But science is catching up maybe to some of this. But anyway, so one place, one time, and really one organism. I don't know if there's any Carl Sagan fans in here. I grew up, as an 11 or 12-year-old watching them on PBS, and I just loved them. I mean, I sat in front of the TV and absorbed it. But he used to start his shows with something like the cosmos is all there is, it's all there ever will be, and it's something like that. It's all there is and all there ever will be. In other words, he was talking about there is one whole thing, and all of the, it's sort of a mystical version of science where everything literally comes from, he would say stardust, but everything comes from one place, and we're all in the same place, and it's all happening here. So kind of a perennial idea there. Now, that's the basic ideas of the perennial idea, but there's some interesting implications of that. If that is true, then there's some things that must also be true. One of those things is there's no real separation between God and people because we're all made of the same thing. You could say we're the organs of God, in a way. That also means if there's no separation, real, actual, fundamental separation between God and people, there's no separation between people and people either, right? So it's a very defensible way. It's a very rock solid way to defend principles such as do unto others as you would have them do unto you. If you understand that they are you in a sense. I mean, you're hurting yourself when you hurt another person. If you think you're not hurting them by, you're actually ignorant of what's really going on because you're connected to that person, and you're affecting your own development by being unfriendly or unkind to them. There is no time or place is one of the implications. And really, another implication is that all religions start with the attempt to explain the same things. Someone has an experience, and then they try to explain that experience to other people who haven't had it, and voila, you get religion. As time goes by, that religion it gets explained to generations, to another generation, and that generation explains it to a generation, and it kind of declines in its understanding of what the original experience was. That seems to be kind of what goes on in the world. Anyway, so I know this probably sounds kind of Eastern to you, or maybe Buddhist or hippie-ish even. Is there any perennialism in Christianity? I mean, we're in a Christian church. We're part of First United Methodist Church. Can we defend any of these ideas, even though we like them, in Christianity? And I think that's a very good question. I think we can. I mean, I think they are justifiable. I think that it is. I want to give you some examples. So sometimes, I haven't heard it lately, but we often start 11:11 services or somewhere in the service we have the scripture, God is not far from any of us. I bet you can finish it. In him we live and move and are, if you use our current translation. But the King James, in him we live and move and have our being. That's pretty cool. That comes from Acts 17. Yeah, Acts 17:28. It's a very interesting concept of God that sounds very Eastern. And of course, Jesus was Eastern, right? He wasn't a Westerner. And this is, I believe, Paul. So that one is straight. We use that all the time. It comes straight out of Acts. How about Jesus himself? Did Jesus say anything that sounds like it would fit into this kind of concept of a perennial truth? Well, in the very beginning of the New Testament, I mean, if you open your Bible to Matthew and you flip it open to... Sorry about that. That help? If you flip it open to chapter 1, and it's, you know, it's the beginnings, it's opening up the story for you in Matthew, it talks about this prophecy of Jesus from the Old Testament, supposed prophecy of Jesus, and it says, his name shall be called Emmanuel, God is with us. And now this is a quote from the Old Testament. Obviously his name was not Emmanuel, it was Jesus. So that they did not literally mean, when they wrote that his name was going to be Jesus. They meant something else. They meant that his role in the scheme of things, in the evolution of things, we might say in a modern way of saying it, was to be a symbol of oneness with God. No more was God this distant thing. And if you read the Old Testament, if you've ever had an Old Testament course or you've read the Old Testament, a lot of it is about how separate God is, right? Only the priest could go into the Holy of Holies and all those things. You may have remembered those stories from Sunday school. The separation of God was a big, big deal. You didn't dare. Or if you've seen Raiders of the Lost Ark, you know how bad it is to reach in there without permission. So anyway, one of my favorite movies. It seems like I bring it up in every sermon. I don't know why. But anyway, so yeah, God is with us. It's a new version of reality is coming, and it's one where there isn't a separation between God and people. They're coming. The understanding is changing, and Jesus is a symbol of that. God is right here with us. So that's at the very beginning of the New Testament, and it shows how the people who wrote at least that testament understood Jesus' significance in Judaism and then later in Christianity. And of course, another one we use, if you turn over to Luke 17, there's the kingdom of God is within you, is a really interesting passage where Jesus says, it's not something, you know, the kingdom of God is within you. If somebody says, go look here or go look there, it's coming, don't believe them, because the kingdom of God is inside you and it's among you all here. Very interesting scripture. Another places he implies that what he's saying is, we're immersed in it. It's not that you have to look for it. You have to just put away the barriers you already have to it. It's already here. You know, it's not something you have to look for. Again, kind of consistent with that view of a different reality being understood, or actually the correct reality being understood more deeply. That's actually the scripture, I believe, right before Jesus walks on water, I think is the next part of that Luke scripture. I was going to go ahead and invite the band to come up, slowly start coming up. Okay, so that's two examples. The third one, I'm going to call God is people, and it comes from Matthew 22:37. And this is where Jesus is asked, what is the greatest commandment in the law? And Jesus answers with a very predictable answer at first. It's the Shema. Or it's part of the Shema. It actually has several different parts. Here, I think the Shema is actually, Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one. And then the second part is actually, it's said with the Shema, but it's called something else. But anyway, you must love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your being, and with all your mind. And every Jew would have known that. So that was not surprising that Jesus said that at all. But then Jesus adds something pretty radical, and I think we miss how radical it is. Because we're so used to hearing it. It's kind of like the Lord's Prayer. I mean, you could say it in your sleep, and you don't really think about each of the words and what they mean anymore. But anyway, he adds this. That's the first commandment. The second is like it. You must love your neighbor as you love yourself. It's a pretty radical, because he's almost equating your neighbor. You want to get close to God? You really want to please God? Then you're going to have to get right with your neighbor. That's where you're going to find God. It's a pretty radical break from the way that Jews would have looked at the separation of God. And here Jesus is equating peace with God with peace with people and making it, and of course it became one of the pillars of Christianity, of course. So you must love your neighbor as you love yourself. And then, in case it's not clear, there's one more sentence. All of the law and the prophets depend on these two commands. There you go. If you want the answer to what the message of Jesus really is, and you can't figure it out because it's just all over the place, here you go. It's summarized, and even in Jesus' own words, these are the two commandments you need to stick with. Start there, and from there you can understand everything else. I forgot to do this slide thing. That's my unity slide. Sorry. I forgot to do my fake clicking. One more click. Okay, this is my God is people slide. Sorry about that. So as it turns out, God is so close you can almost taste it. He really is close. Literally, that is the truth. And because of that, there's every reason for high hopes. So go out there and fulfill the prophecy. Amen.
Always had high, high hopes. Had to have high, high hopes for a living. Didn't know how, but I always had a feeling I was gonna be that one in a million. Always had high, high hopes. Mama said, fulfill the prophecy, be something great. Go make a legacy, manifest destiny. Back in the days, we wanted everything, wanted everything. Mama said, burn your biographies, rewrite your history, light up your body streams, museum victories. Every day we wanted everything, mama said, don't give up, it's a little complicated, all tied up, no more love, and I hate to see you waiting. Had to have high, high hopes for the living, shooting for the stars when I couldn't make a killing, didn't have the time, but I always had a vision. Always had high, high hopes. Had to have high, high hopes for a living. Didn't know how, but I always had a feeling I was gonna be that one in a million. Had to have high, high hopes. Mama said, it's a bit of oddity, stranger says. Ain't ever wanna be the weird and the novelties. Don't ever change, we wanted everything. Wanted everything. Stay up on that ride. Come down. Stay up on that rise. Stay up on that rise and never come down. Mama said, don't give up. It's a little complicated. All tied up, no more love, and I hate to see you waiting. They said it's all been done, but we haven't seen the best of me. Yeah, yeah, yeah. So I got one more love, gonna be a sight to see. Hey, hey, hey. Had to have high, high hopes for a living. Shooting for the stars when I couldn't make a killing. Didn't have a dime, but I always had a vision. Always had high, high hopes. Had to have high, high hopes for a living. Didn't know how, but I always had a feeling I was gonna be that one in a million. Always had high, high hopes. Had to have high, high hopes for a living.
So for the benediction, I haven't done this in a while. Go now, as Tom says, as Zach says, go now in pieces. We've all come together as one, but God is always with us as we leave this place. Some of us are going to joy. Some of us are going to crazy places. Some of us are going somewhere in between. Whatever that stress, whatever that joy, whatever that happiness may be, know that we are together even though we're out there. Go now in peace. Go in pieces. Amen.